Frank Winfield Woolworth was born on April 13, 1852 in Rodman, New York. He later attended business school in Waterton, New York, and afterwards, he got a job in Augbury and Moore's dry goods store. He struggled as a sales clerk but was good at merchandising displays. He learned how to attract customers, indicating the notion that goods should sell themselves. Where his five and dime concept began is debated amongst, but some say it was at the store. He created a 5-cent only table with all merchandise just 5 cents, and it was very successful. From here, he wanted to expand on this successful idea. Wanting to go out on his own, Frank Woolworth borrowed $300 from his former boss, William Moore, and opened his first store in New York on February 22, 1879, known as a 5-cent store. The store failed quickly, but he did not give up. After making enough money to pay back Moore the loan, Frank opened a new store, Woolworth's Great 5-Cent Store, a few months later in Lancaster, Pennsylvania. At this time, he brought in the help of his brother, Charles Sumner Woolworth, who went by Sum. It wasn't until 1880 when their store in Scranton, Pennsylvania, named 5-Cent and 10-Cent Woolworth Bros Store, did the 5-and-dime concept progress to a successful layout. Increasing its product availability by including merchandise that also cost a dime, the change increased sales and led to his survival. Soon, Sum bought out his brother's stake in the Scranton store and branched out on his own to open even more stores, becoming the first franchisee of Woolworth. He brought in other partners such as Fred Kirby, who also branched out to open additional locations. Moving away from the, at the time, traditional look of a retail store after already getting rid of the typical shelving and fixtures, Frank Woolworth adapted a new look that his brother Sum had started. These stores featured a polished wooden floor with bright lights. This new look became a standard for future retail establishments to show cleaner stores with a better presentation. Even with different owners throughout, Frank teamed with all of them and didn't consider one another rivals, but instead they worked together to bring a maximum purchasing power for the inventory to get better deals and more varieties of inventory. By 1904, there were 6 different chains affiliated with the original Woolworth store in both the United States and now into Canada. 10 years later, he had 12 stores total. By 1900, he had 59 and annual sales over $5 million. By 1911, the F.W. Woolworth Company had 586 stores. In 1910, the F.W. Woolworth Company commissioned the world's tallest building in New York City. Designed by Cass Gilbert, the building was completed in 1913. The structure cost $13.5 million in cash, and standing at 792 feet, the Woolworth Building, which served as the company's headquarters, was the tallest building in the world until 1930. In 1912, Frank created a plan for all the stores to join forces and to create one corporation using the name F.W. Woolworth Company that merged all 596 stores. All 6 different owners unanimously agreed. He purchased merchandise directly from manufacturers to allow a lower selling price. In addition, using self-service display cases went away with the necessity of sales clerks to be present to sell. Customers were able to handle items themselves without having to ask, as well as be pressured to buy. Instead, Woolworth encouraged customers to browse the products without sales pressure. Unfortunately, Frank Woolworth died on April 8, 1919, at the age of 66. When he died, his company had over 1,000 stores and he was worth approximately $76 million. The 5-and-dime structure continued until 1932 when they introduced a 20-cent line. November 13, 1935, though, the company stopped selling at a price limit and went with the more traditional sales model as seen in retail stores today. After beginning the chain of 5-and-dimes, Woolworth soon had new competitors, such as S.S. Kresge, who opened his first 5-and-dime store in 1897. Kresge, later on, would start K-Mart, one of the companies that would help drive Woolworths out of business. Woolworths themselves drove a lot of small businesses and mom-and-pop shops out of business by providing an easier shopping experience and providing cheaper priced merchandise. It was the first big box style one-stop shop. Woolworth found a way to drive in more business during the middle of the 20th century when stores in the US copied ideas from the United Kingdom and began serving food at a lunch counter. The Woolworth lunch counter is famous due to the 1960 Greensboro sit-ins during the Civil Rights Movement. On February 1st of 1960, four African Americans sat down at the whites only lunch counter and asked for coffee. Store manager asked them to leave, but they did not. They stayed until closing but came back the following day with more than 20 other students. After the media spread the news nationwide and more sit-ins that increased in size and expanded to different stores the following few months through Greensboro, stores that were boycotted lost approximately one-third of sales and managers' salaries were reduced for not meeting sales goals. Afterwards, Woolworth store manager Clarence Harris asked four of his African-American employees to change clothes and be served at the Woolworth counter. The last remaining Woolworth's food counter in the United States is still open in Bakersfield, California, where the original building is open today as an antique store. After specializing in the five-and-dime concept, the Woolworth Company decided to expand beginning in the 1960s to other specialized items. They started a new chain of discount stores called Woolco in 1962. That same year, Target, K-Mart, and Walmart all opened, which created new competition. In 1963, Woolworth branched out into the shoe business and purchased Kinney Shoe Corporation, where the company would learn the shoe business, which will later help with its survival into the 21st century. In 1979, Woolworth's was known as the largest department store chain in the world. So how did the company decline so fast? By the 1980s, competition had gotten too high for the once seemingly unstoppable retail powerhouse. In the 1980s, the company expanded with different specialty formats for stores such as jewelry, pharmaceuticals, and clothing outerwear. These stores were branched out too much and being placed in the anchor of shopping malls, the concept failed and the idea was quickly changed. It changed their model to include numerous smaller concept specialty stores in each mall, but that idea never happened. They decided to make a smaller model store based on the original business model called Woolworth Express, but that also soon fizzled. Once the company moved away from the traditional five and dime model, the company increased with change, but the success did not last. By focusing on smaller specialty stores, less focus was on the Woolworth stores that helped them compete. So much competition and having geared away from its traditional store model that made the company once successful, Woolworth declined, and by 1993, they restructured and decided to close half of their stores. By 1997, with only 400 stores remaining, all the United States stores shut down when the chain went out of business on July 17, 1997. Most of the remaining Woolco stores were sold to Walmart. After closing Woolworth stores, the company changed directions to focus more on sporting goods and specialty items they had once begun in the 1960s and 70s. They purchased the East Bay Sporting Goods catalog in 1997 and Woolworth, which changed their name to Venator, the same year but again changed their name in 2001 to a company they had started in 1974, Foot Locker. Included in the history of Foot Locker is the story of Woolworth, where their history is surviving today but in a format that F.W. Woolworth would likely have never imagined. The United Kingdom stores, which had been under separate ownership since 1982, eventually closed in 2009. There are still Woolworth stores in Australia and South Africa, but these stores have no connection to the F.W. Woolworth company and only use the name since at the time there were no trademarks in those countries.